front of the mirror right now. Because like you, I want to be energized, the energy. So let me introduce our guest. Today we have with us Wayne Chandler, who is an anthropophotojournalist specializing in ancient Asian philosophy and high cultural development. He has designed an alternative curriculum for the National Trust school system. Wayne Chandler was a consultant via What's a Face Productions for the Portland, Oregon schools in the revision of a multicultural curriculum for African Americans. Wayne Chandler helped implement the Genius Transformation Program, which demonstrated successfully that when underprivileged children are exposed to proper historical information and lifestyle, their self-esteem and outlook are positively impacted. From 1985 through to 1995, he was a regular contributor and co-author to the Journal of African Civilizations, High Cultural Development. He has written several books, including Ancient Future, and he has made a contribution in African present early Asia. That's just some of the things about Wayne. And I'm sure there's many more things you learned today, and I'm sure we leave here much more energized and the journey continues. So without further delay, can I invite Wayne Chandler to speak?
This evening, one explore like the whole idea of connection, you know, feminine, masculine, energy, what is that? And what does that look like when it feeds into the mix of relationship? And what are some of the cultural, you know, challenges that we face with respect to relationships, the relationships that we get into today? So one of the things I like just to begin with is, you know, how our ancestors, the ancient Egyptians, you know, how they looked at the whole dynamic of human beings connecting with one another. And they believed that every individual, when you come upon this planet, that you're connected to 2,000 other individuals, that you're connected to 2,000 souls. And that every time you have a breakthrough in your life, you know, or you ascend to a higher feeling or a higher vibrational frequency, you know, dealing with your consciousness or what have you, that you lift these other 2,000 individuals. They ascend with you into a higher frame of consciousness, you know, or a higher vibrational frequency of perception. You know, regardless of how slight your revelation might be, you affect 2,000 other people. Out of these 2,000 people that you're connected to, some of these people will come into your life and will come into your life as significant others. Some of them will be soulmates, some of them will be twin flames, you know, some of them, you know, will just be connected, you know, through past life experiences as friends or partners or what have you. Now, the whole idea of a soulmate, you know, a soulmate is someone who comes into your life that you've experienced, you know, in a past incarnation. So our ancient ancestors have always said that, you know, who comes to you many times as a soulmate doesn't necessarily mean that this person is designed specifically to walk the rest of your life with you. This person could be coming just to bring information to you. You know, and that information, you know, the lessons that they bring to the table, you know, you may feel that these are great lessons, and then again, you may feel these are the worst lessons you could ever have, but they are lessons that feed into your development, your personal development, and your growth. So a soulmate, the idea of a soulmate is not always a pleasant experience. It's an individual that comes into your life so that you can begin to grow, develop, you know, to evolve. However that may look, you know, a lot of times, you know, you meet somebody and, you know, you say, wow, man, this person is beautiful. This is the person I'm waiting for, like, all my days. Then 3 years, 2 years later, you're like, man, why are you here, you know? I cursed the day I met you. So, you know, know, so it shifts, it changes, you know. What seems to be, you know, one thing turns out to be something else altogether different. Now, twin flame is a really interesting dynamic, because a twin flame is somebody that truly is an aspect of yourself. And what the ancient Egyptians stated about twin flames is that twin flames originate from the core. They come from the source. So at the very source, when all things are created, this one soul, this one individual soul, splits into two or more souls. And each one of those souls follows a different path, takes a different journey to experience different aspects of that same journey. So many times when you have someone that comes into your life and you just have this resonance with them, you feel them, you know, and it's like you're looking in a mirror, you know, and everything flows. There is true synchronization. That's a twin flame experience, you know, because this individual is an aspect of your soul, you know. So it's rare that we come across and we meet our twin flames, you know, but when it does happen, you know, it's an incredible experience. You know, it's one that really bonds you with this individual for the rest of your days. So you have many different kinds of relationships. You know, you have the soul connection, and then you have you know, the relationship that is based on sexual attraction. You know, it's based on sexual chemistry. You know, you meet somebody and there's a certain type of, you know, pheromonal, you know, attraction that really has not a lot to do with anything else, you know, but the sex is good, you know, so you all are like, you know, connected in that way. Then you have, like, you know, the mental, the mind connection, the mind to mind. And the mind to mind connection are two people that have, like, a similar, like, mental rapport, and that's how they vibe with each other. You know? I mean, they really feel each other, like, in their head, you know, and that's, nothing else needs to matter, you know, because it's intellectual, you know. So there is a basis, you know, of connection, you know, just through how they perceive, you know, their realities through the mind. And then you have, like, the soulmate connection. And then you have, like, the type of relationship, you know, that has a little bit of all these different elements, you know, like just rolled up into one, which is ideal, you know. I mean, that's what you want, you know. And then you have your heaven on earth, you know, you can just, you know, do it. My feeling, you know, is that in terms of relationship, I personally feel that if you don't really have an understanding, or even more importantly, an understanding of what constitutes masculine and feminine energy, your relationships are not going to endure. They will be very fleeting, you know, because the idea of men and women, especially in this particular culture, you know, we speak two different languages. You know, I call it he speaks, she speaks. You know, so because we're wired differently, we perceive reality in a different way. Now, our ancestors have told us that, you know, we all have an aspect of the other. You know, so every man has an aspect of feminine energy that moves through them. That's how we're divinely created. Every woman has an aspect of the masculine, you know, within her. That's how we're divinely created and designed. No, but the he speaks, she speaks, you know, because women are just kind of wired to a totally different process than men are. So he speaks, she speaks. This is women's English. In other words, this is how men hear women and women speak. To a man, when a woman says yes, she means no. Says no, she means yes. Maybe means no. It's your decision means the correct decision should be obvious by now. Do what you want means you'll pay for this later. We need to talk means I need to complain, sure. Go ahead means I don't want you to. I'm not upset means of course I'm upset, idiot. Be romantic, turn out the lights. Men hear as I have flabby thighs, I don't want to be seen. This kitchen is so inconvenient, is heard as I want a new house. I want new curtains, is heard as and carpeting and furniture and wallpaper. I heard a noise, is heard as I noticed you were almost asleep. Do you love me? Men hear as I'm going to ask for something expensive. How much do you love me? Men hear as I did something today you're really not going to like. Is my butt fat? Hears tell me I'm beautiful. You have to learn to communicate, is heard as just agree with me. Are you listening to me? Men hear as too late, I'm dead. Men's English. Now this is how women hear men. I'm hungry is heard as I'm hungry. I'm sleepy means I'm sleepy. I'm tired means I'm tired. Do you want to go to a movie? It's heard as I'd eventually like to have sex with you. Can I take you out to dinner? It's heard as I'd eventually like to have sex with you. Can I call you sometime? It's heard as I'd eventually like to have sex with you. May I have this dance? It's heard as I'd eventually like to have sex with you. Nice dress. It's heard as nice cleavage. You look tense. Let me give you a massage. It's heard as I want to fondle you. What's wrong? It's heard as what meaningless self-inflicted psychological trauma are you going through now? What's wrong? It's heard as, man, I guess sex tonight is out of the question. I'm bored. It's heard as, do you want to have sex? I love you. It's heard as, let's have sex now. I love you too. It's heard as, okay, I said it, we better have sex now. Let's talk. It's heard as, I am trying to impress you by showing that I am a deep person, and maybe then you'd like to have sex with me. Will you marry me? Is heard as, I want to make it illegal for you to have sex with other guys. You know, so we have, like, this humor, but I mean, this is taken from, like, you know, there's truth in that. You know, there's a lot of truth that moves between the lines of these humorous situations. When you look at culture, culture evolves many of the ideas, you know, the patterns of how we relate to one another. So when you look at ancient cultures, you know, you see that they have a certain reverence for the masculine and the feminine. So the universe was brought into being, you know, by a feminine force and a masculine force. And you find that throughout all of the ancient cultures of the world, you know, regardless of whether you're looking in the various countries in Africa, you know, whether you're looking into India, you know, China, you find all of these like essential reproductive generating dynamics, you know, that come into play between the masculine and the feminine energy, you know, that creates life. So we know that it takes both of these to truly bring life into being. But it's really profound to me that we live in a culture in the West, where the universe and everything else was created by an exclusively masculine series of entities, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All of them reflect and resonate a masculine essence, which means that in the mentality of the West, everything was born out of the masculine, and that there was no feminine energy that came into play to create anything. So you have to look at, if this is indeed our reality, you have to look at how that begins to shape and form our perception of relationship from the earliest years and growing up through adolescence into adulthood, how we begin to perceive that reality. You know that, you know, women aren't really needed in the generation and regeneration, in the life-giving process, that there's really no place for them, that as men, that we can do everything ourselves without the aid of the feminine. Duality is in everything. Gender is in everything. Everything throughout the universe. Nothing can happen. Nothing can be brought into being without the combination of masculine and feminine energy moving together, connecting, unifying, creating a unified force. Nothing can come into generation without that dynamic happening. Even the brain, the mind, you know, is broken down into various dualities, you know, and they speak to it. They speak to this masculine and feminine aspect of the mind, you know. So you have, you know, the conscious mind, you have the subconscious mind, you know, you have the voluntary and the involuntary mind. You have the passive and the active aspects of mind. You have the I and the me aspect of mind. And basically what this is showing us is that the mind has duality, you know? So when we look at that, even as we develop, you know, as we begin to evolve, you know, as kids, you know, pre-teen and going into adolescence, you know, think about those times, you know, when you were that age and you were like feeling your immortality, you know, I mean, you were invulnerable, you know? I mean, you weren't thinking about anything, you know, that had to do with limitation. Limitation was like a really abstract concept to you. You know, you were the most creative than you've ever been in your life during that time. Many of you may have been into art, may have been into dance, you may have been exploring so many different creative venues, you know, and you get to a certain time in your life where you just seem to gravitate, you know, away from those, and you stop and you think and you wonder, why did I leave that? Why did I step out of that experience? You know, because it gave me a lot of joy. Pre-adolescence through adolescence, we're using an aspect of our brain, which is called the medulla oblongata. It's the purely feminine aspect of the mind. It's the purely feminine expression. So it gives to us, imparts to us, all of those qualities, you know, which are carried by feminine energy and the manifestation of, like, feminine thought. But as we get older and we move into, you know, our early 20s to mid-20s, it all shifts. And before we know it, we're moving with a very linear train of thought. Our perception becomes very linear. You know, how we perceive our reality, you know, becomes very linear. Now, what does that mean? Linear means ordinarily with feminine thought and action, it moves in two geometric patterns. One is a circle and one is a spiral. Masculine energy being linear just moves straight. It's a straight line. Now, it's not to say that one is greater than the other. They both work together harmoniously. But when you have one and you're using just one exclusively, then you have a problem. So what happens is that as we get into our early 20s, early to mid 20s, we become exclusively like moving along a linear plane. We become really preoccupied with a certain masculine existence and operation. We begin to see things through masculine eyes, through the eyes of the masculine, and the feminine energy is downplayed more and more the older we get. This is because we live in a culture that does not support, nurture, or allow the feminine aspect to thrive. As a matter of fact, it is always trying to subjugate that energy. And it's not a new occurrence. This is something that has been in the fabric of our culture for thousands of years. And so it's literally like inseparable from the culture. It's never going to go anywhere because it helps to make the planetary reality what it is. So when you look at the whole idea of how men today are put upon, in the States, you know, I find like some of these images to be just incredibly fascinating. So I was looking through a magazine once and I saw this, and you know, men have always been dogs in the past, but now we've gone to a new low where now we're pigs. And I saw this and I just thought this was comical but sad. But you have to ask yourself, you know, is this where we have really gone? Is this how we as men appear in the eyes of the feminine? You know, how are they looking at us? How are they looking into our souls? You know, I mean, in the way this is depicted, you know, sisters get tired of being come on like this, you know, being approached, and you know, so it's, there's truth, just like the first little piece that I read. In something that is this outlandish, there's truth when you look at it through the eyes of the feminine. Here, in this culture, this is our brain. Now, we live in a masculine, dominant, patriarchal culture. Living in such a place means that there's a certain environment within the mind that allows us peace and tranquility, and that aspect of the mind is the left brain. That the left brain allows the expression of only that which is tangible to be considered real. So when you look at the so-called attributes, you know, or the characteristics of the left brain, it's time-bound. It processes information bit by bit. It's sequential, A to B, B to C. It looks at detail. It splits the world into our identifiable bits and pieces. It looks for cause and effect. It asks how. It focuses on information. It uses words to name, describe, and define. It's deductive in that it draws a specific conclusion from broad premises, but all the information necessary for the conclusion is contained in the premise. Seems like cheating, doesn't it? Tends to focus on grammar. Now, sequence, words, numbers, analysis, logic, linear dimensions list, the conscious is focused out. So, this is the dimension that is dealing with three-dimensional reality. In other words, it's connected only to what the five senses can respond to.
The way we're made is we're multi-dimensional beings. We're put together in a way that allows us to evolve through a very powerful multi-dimensional environment. In other words, you have energetic centers in your body that lay dormant and inactive in your body because we live in a three-dimensional
environment. This three-dimensional environment only allows us to connect with that which is relative to the five senses. So in other words, if you can't see it, if you can't smell it, taste it, touch it, you know, like feel it, it doesn't exist. That's the mentality of the left brain. When you look at the time-bound dynamic of the left brain, you're looking at a death-based consciousness. Now, when you go into the right brain, the feminine mind is timeless as opposed to being time-bound. So in other words, where this reality is finite, it sees an end to everything. So we come here believing in death before we even begin to live. But the feminine is timeless, is dealing strictly with infinity. It processes information all at once instead of processing information bit by bit. It's simultaneous. It looks at the whole as opposed to splitting the world into identifiable bits and pieces. It connects the world into a connected whole. Everything in our reality is connected. Everybody in this room is connected to everything else. Everybody in this room is connected to each other. The whole idea of separation is an illusion. There's no such thing as separation. Whether you can see the connections or not, you know, if you were in a place where you could like activate and see through your higher senses, if your higher senses were activated, you could see the various cords that extend from the chakras in your body and connect to the different individuals that you meet. The feminine mind looks for relationships. It asks why. It focuses on emotions. It uses pictures, shapes, and colors.
It's inductive.
Draws a general conclusion from broad premises, going beyond the information that is given. Now think about that. It goes beyond the information that is given. So it moves with a telepathic, intuitive, and psychic process. That's its essence. That's the essence of the feminine. Now, it looks for relationships. It focuses on emotions. Now when you step over here, ain't no relationship mechanism in here. And it sure ain't no emotional mechanism in here.
So when we look at this, what we get is that We live in a male-dominant culture. And living in a male-dominant culture and not being connected to the feminine aspect of ourselves as men is a very deep and limiting process, because it disconnects us from a very deep and profound aspect of ourselves, as well as disconnecting us from our ability to access the divine, and it disconnects us from our significant others. Now, the way it does this is because this culture is always in the process of subjugating and battering the feminine. So the fact that we as men are made to feel that if we connect to the feminine aspect of ourself, that we are weak, because the feminine is put to us, painted as a weak dynamic in the whole creative process, this creative process that came about by only masculine deities. So the mere fact, you know, if a man shows emotion, if a man shows feeling, if a man cries, these are all aspects that are feminine based, that we're made to feel insecure about, though we carry these things. So we wonder as men, well, how do we deal with these different aspects, because they're there. You know, we can't just push them aside, they're real, but the culture is always putting a certain degree of pressure and enculturation upon us to make sure that these aspects of our being are pushed and swept, as they say, under the rug. So we don't connect to the feminine aspect of ourselves to really get an understanding of what constitutes our different emotional fields. Relationship? Man, that's a foreign concept. So the feminine in this culture has been put upon, some may say, since time immemorial. So when you look at our ancient history, you go back over 5,000 years, and you find the first documents that were put together which dealt with the whole subservient, the servitude of women. The oldest comes out of a scripture known as the Law of Manu. And it says, I'm just going to read a couple, but you'll get the idea from those couple that I read exactly where I'm going with this. The mind of woman brooks not discipline, for her intellect has little weight. To kill women and blacks, one need not worry, for it is not a sin. All of these were written into every religious text on the planet Earth. Untruthfulness, rashness, guile, stupidity, avarice, uncleanliness, and cruelty are a woman's seven natural faults. Women have hunger twofold, shame fourfold, inconsideration sixfold, and lust eightfold more than a man. But you see, I mean, we're talking about, these were religious concepts that became divine law. And it became the very fabric of this culture that we are a part of. Because, see, the feminine holds the key to our liberation, as we'll get into a little bit later. Another book of equal ancient antiquity that's known as the Mahabharata. In the Mahabharata, it states this, and it's really the way this was framed was really deep, because it's between two great divine entities. One was Uma, the sister of the universe, and Shiva. So like Shiva is asking this sister, well, what are the duties of woman? And so Uma, this woman is supposed to say to Shiva, these are the duties of woman. Can you imagine one of you sisters in here saying this to a man? The duties of woman are created in the rites of wedding. When in presence of the nuptial fire, she becomes the associate of her lord or husband for the performance of all righteous deeds. She should be beautiful and gentle, considering her husband as her god and serving him as such in fortune and misfortune, health and sickness, obedient, even if commanded to unrighteous deeds or acts that may lead to her own destruction. She should rise early, serving her God, always keeping her house clean, tending to the domestic sacred fire, eating only after the needs of her God and guests and servants have been satisfied, devoted to her father and mother and the father and mother of her husband. Devotion to her Lord is a woman's honor. That is her eternal heaven. So this lays the groundwork for women to be put in a place within this cultural schematic that you all ain't never gonna rise from. Because we're talking about thousands of years of prejudice, gender bias, omission, subjugation. In Christianity, in the Catholic Encyclopedia, it states, and I quote, the female sex is in some respects inferior to the male sex, both as regards to body and mind. In Corinthians 11:3, St. Paul said, the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man. Now, some of the greatest Christian proponents and advocates that Christians embrace and adhere to in terms of their philosophies, Martin Luther declared, if women get tired and die of bearing, there is no harm in that. Let them die as long as they bear. It is that for which they were made. Clement of Alexandria was quoted as saying, every woman ought to be filled with shame at the thought that she is a woman. And one of the greatest Christian advocates throughout all of Christian history, St. Thomas Aquinas, says, every woman is birth defective. And yeah, I know. Is birth defective, an imperfect male begotten that way because her father was either ill, debilitated, or in a sinful condition at the time of her conception. Now, what I want you to get from that, yeah, it's so ridiculous that it's comical, but to feel the level of hatred for the feminine that this culture carries. Now, you have what are called paradigm shifts. And paradigm shifts basically are patterns of illusion that are brought about to make you think things are better than they are. Because, see, this creates the model. This creates the very model, and this is what we as men, all of us, have been enculturated with. It's inescapable for us. From the time we're like this and growing up, we get it. I mean, literally, I have read those same things in certain audiences, and brothers will say, yeah, that's right. That's where it's supposed to be. And I'm like, you know, who am I talking to? You know, do we know who we are and what we are? We have no idea how this culture has impacted us. We have no idea. So when you look at masculine to feminine energy, it has its positives, you know? I mean, it works together in harmonious accord. The masculine has its attributes, the feminine has its attributes. Now, masculine energy, the ancient Egyptians said, the left brain is the masculine brain, that it functions and moves through the world with a sense of separateness from everything else. It makes real, and it creates the ability to say, this belongs to me, and that it's territorial. These are mine. The ancient Egyptians said, the masculine mind does not instinctively flow with nature. In other words, it's separate from the natural world. It doesn't really understand the natural flow, the universal, organic, intrinsic dynamic that all of us are moving with, that enlivens all of us. The masculine mind is separate from all of that. It deals with a very mundane reality. Now, our ancestors say that the right brain is the feminine mind, and that that mind deals with a much more lofty expression of consciousness, and that its purpose is to take this consciousness and to nurture the universe, the earth, humanity. The masculine mind is a state of being. Feminine mind is a state of becoming. The masculine mind and the feminine mind, its essential characteristics are this. The feminine, in terms of feminine energy, I'm not talking about women right now, I'm talking about feminine energy as a universal force. The purpose, based on divine design, of feminine energy is the search and the manifestation for and of love. Love and nurturing is the search of the feminine. And the feminine needs this as sustenance to feed the universe, the planet, humanity. Now, when this energy, when this feminine force enters into the female body, it takes with it that prime objective, which is to give love, to receive love, to nurture, and to receive nurture. If that's not forthcoming, like the real expression of true love, you know, then the feminine would rather get a pint of ice cream or chocolate bar, or, you know, go to a romantic movie or read a romantic novel. The masculine, on the other hand, the two key words for masculine energy is freedom and the mission. Freedom and the mission. All men, when that energy incorporates into them, they want to live a life on the edge. They want to feel the bliss of being involved in things that are exciting, always moving, action-based. And if men, as a man, can't get involved in those things, then they'll watch it on TV in you know, the form of sports shows or, I don't know, cop programs or something, you know? But it's that need to feel like the wind at your feet. That's the masculine. So when you have masculine energy that moves with the intent of the mission and freedom, and feminine energy that's moving with the intent of love and nurturing, and you put that together in the mix, it becomes essential that the masculine can connect to its feminine to really have the understanding of connection. Because if not, the masculine will never understand the language that is spoken through the emotional field of feminine energy and be able to embrace its needs. So you'll hear sisters say, damn, I mean, he's never around. You know, he's always going here, going there, doing this, doing that. Or he's been working on this forever. All he does is work, 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 work. Doesn't come home, meet three kids. He's out working, talking about he's creating some kind of vision. He got to bring this into being. He got to bring that into being. What the hell is he talking about? These are the things that come into play, you know? The difference that's created within the context of relationship. You all follow me so far? So when we look at feminine energy as a force, remember that it's a state of becoming. So our ancestors used two interlocking circles that they called, or what has come to be known as, the Vesica Pisces. Two interlocking circles. This is what they say about those circles. It says it is the symbol for the creative feminine force that brought the material universe into being. It represents the fundamental energy which lies at the basis of all creation, and without it, nothing could be. Let me read that again. It represents the fundamental energy which lies at the basis of all creation. This is feminine energy we're talking about. And without it, nothing could be. To remove its energy from all form and matter would bring about the immediate disintegration of the universe. That's how deep feminine energy is. This is what we're kept away from, because this is our true doorway to self-empowerment. This is what this culture has a very, very deep knowledge of. And when this culture was designed, it was designed with the intent to make sure that you never, ever get to a place where you understand the true nature of your abilities and your powers. So it put in play all of these various laws and paradigms to make sure that as men, we never access our feminine aspect, and as women, you feel so subjugated and depressed with respect to your own femininity that you won't go any deeper or further to explore it. This is the game that is run upon us. And this is where we sit with it. Spherical energy, feminine force, from seashells, looking at the spiral, all things spiral. From DNA, oh, that's right. This thing has a quirk in it. Okay, now it's two slides in one. Anyway, that's a galaxy. And, so, the power of feminine energy is that it liberates, it frees, it allows us to access our divine nature. The doorway to the divine is in the right hemisphere, in the feminine mind. That's where it is. It's not in the left brain. It's not in the left masculine hemisphere. So when you talk about evolution, when you talk about self-empowerment, when you talk about elevating your level of consciousness, you must move through the doorway, the portal of the feminine mind to access them. The feminine brain is the cause. And the masculine mind is the effect. It's the illusion. Now, if you remember talking about reality and illusion, if you can remember the image of the brain that was up there, and you remember the masculine mind was blue, the feminine was red. In the Matrix, when Morpheus went to see Neo, and Morpheus reached in his pocket and pulled out the pills, and he says to Neo, if you take the blue pill, the story ends here. You wake up in your bed, you believe whatever you want to believe. But if you take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and then I'll show you just how deep the rabbit hole goes. That's what he was talking about. He was talking about the hemispheres of the brain, the masculine mind and the feminine mind. One being time-bound and based in illusion, and one being infinite and based on infinite possibility. So when we look at this culture and what it does to the feminine, because the culture is linear and male dominant, You got to remember, it goes to no lengths to put upon us in our minds that being linear and masculine is the best way to express yourself, the best way to appear. So we have models that are put in front of us that we're supposed, that the women are supposed to emulate. Stick them, because they reflect the perfect image of a cultural reality, a linear reality. Straight up and down. So we as men are supposed to want our women like men. Can you dig that? And as we move into the whole relationship dynamic, you know, because now we take all those different elements that I just spoke about and you put them all in the mix of relationship, and what you come up with is pure, unadulterated confusion. Relationship becomes a living hell or nightmare. And so you have magazine covers that are talking about make him commit, not just a little bit, make him commit 100%. Why? Because he is too much into his freedom. He is too much into his freedom, so we're going to make this man commit 100%. 25, not one, not two, I mean five would have been a lot, but I could even go with five. But 25 ways to get your man into a rock solid relationship. Really, 25 ways to get a man into a rock solid relationship. And you know what's really sad? I'm going to tell you, it's bad. You know, I never even read the article. And I should have read that article. 25 ways, make him commit 100% and 25 ways to get him in there. That's deep. Black woman, today's black woman. Tired of fighting, how black men and women can end the battle of the sexes. TBW asks, black men, how about respect? Should women settle? What to do when he won't commit? That freedom dynamic again comes up a lot, doesn't it? So we look at all these different issues, and we look at the he speaks, she speaks issues, and how patriarchy has created these various dynamics that we have to live through each and every day of our lives. So some things that I've jotted down, six, in terms of how, first, I see patriarchal culture affecting the women, the consciousness of the women in our life. No spiritual love or nurturing. Women try to fill this unmet need vicariously by becoming a caregiver, especially to men who appear needy. In time, there's disrespect. The man will disrespect you for feeding his weakness because he already disrespects himself for being needy. Two, patriarchy creates the illusion and myth of the weaker sex. Being made to feel dependent, you're terrified of abandonment. You will go out of your way to sacrifice to keep your relationship from dissolving. Almost nothing is too much trouble if it will help keep the man you are involved with. You give up your power, dependency. You end up hating the man you are with because you hate yourself for allowing such emotional dependency. Dependency is slavery. 3, not knowing love, accustomed to its lack. In your personal relationship, you are willing to wait, hope, and try harder to please. You are willing to take more than 50% of the responsibility, guilt, and blame in any relationship. And you know, the deep thing about that is you're putting this on yourself while all the time you know that it's not yours to carry. You know it. In relationships, number 4, you are much more in touch with your dream of how it could be than the reality of your situation, of what it is. Patriarchy has been able to crush your self-esteem, and deep inside you, there's an unconscious belief you must earn the right to be happy. And the last, because of the idea of being powerless, you have a desperate need to control your man and your relationship. You mask your efforts to control as being helpful. Coming into a place of awakening, really, I would say awareness, but it's really an awakening, you know, for both men and women about how we're being affected by this culture on a daily basis. And how this is like a disease, it's like a virus that infects us, that really moves us to interact with each other in specifically culturally designed patterns. And when you move like that, the outcome is always going to be inevitable. It's always going to be the same. That's why so many marriages fail. Because they all are based and built on the same basic premise of how to move and engage relationship. And it's all a lie. It's a cultural fabrication. But we move with it anyway. Even though we look around us and we see so many failed marriages and relationships, and we know the design, the pattern that they're built on. But we move along with the same pattern anyway, knowing that it's going to fail. Because you're basing, I'm doing the same thing as Matilda's doing. I'm doing the same thing as this brother over here is doing. Man, his stuff didn't work out. Her stuff didn't work out. Why should my stuff work out? Well, I'm different. My stuff is going to work out more better. Now, 2-3 years down the road, same thing because you're using the same formula. So at some point, you've got to get to a place where you're using a different formula to make things happen, to make things real. A sister I was involved with some time ago who really, I have to say, brought me into my awakening with respect to this whole dynamic of masculine and feminine energy. And when we met, I think it was like at this big conference with Ivan Van Sertima and a lot of other brothers who were there, you know. And we met, and she came to me and approached me
as, yeah, I desire to have you eventually be as my significant other. Right now, you know, I'd like to share information. I'd like you to teach me some things. So for, you know, 3 years, she pretty much, if you will, sat at my feet, picking up all the information I had about everything I had to give her. Then, for the next 3 years, I sat at her feet as she taught me the intricacies of what relationship and masculine and feminine energy were all about. I found this letter. This is like 6 pages of different things, and the way she wrote this to me was really profound. You know, not when I read through it from where I am now. But I want to read this one excerpt because it's relevant to both the sisters in here and the brothers because it's an awakening. It's her awakening, her revelation. And the way she wrote it was she quoted like famous individuals, right? And then she would break it down in terms of what that meant to her. So she has a quote here by this actress by the name of Katharine Hepburn. Katharine Hepburn says, and I quote, "Sometimes I wonder if men and women really suit each other. Perhaps they should live next door and just visit every now and then." Then the sister goes on and she says, "This reminded me of something similar that Alice Walker once said. I think we really have to face honestly just how much this culture shapes us and how much we day to day have to work to keep it from consuming us. I have to face honestly how much I have internalized this paternal culture where I am to work in service of men. And you have to face honestly how much you have internalized your right to be served. I look back at our interactions at their very beginning, and I see a woman who would have done just about anything for the man. And I see a man who would have let her. I see two very typical Americans. And then I see myself now, so radically different, so much more conscious, so much more awake. I'm not that person. Right now, at this moment, I have no desire to do anything for anybody except myself, to grow and to live." So, to move into a place where you begin to really actualize the impact that your environment has had on you, only at that point where you begin to shift and change the nature of the relationship that you attract to yourself. We have to change because we attract to us the relationships that we have based on who we are. So, if you're thinking, "I'm lonely, I want to have a man in my life," or "I want to have a woman in my life because I'm lonely," then what is the base motivation for that? What is the base intention for that? The motivation itself is fear. It's the fear of being lonely. So what are you going to attract? You know what you're going to attract? You're going to attract more loneliness because you're going to attract an individual into your life that is going to mirror that aspect of your fear. So how you think about what you want to bring into your life is very important. You want to shift yourself. The more you shift as an individual,
then the more you will attract that which you need that reflects who and what you have become in your own core. He speaks, she speaks. The masculine is a state of being. This is for the brothers. What's for the sisters too, because it's about creating a level of awareness about exactly what's going on and the thought process that's at work here. And a lot of times when you hear certain things as women, you're going to cringe, you know, because it's not your desired vision of what you want to see with respect to relationship and your man, but it just is what it is. So this is what it is. So don't, it ain't me. It just is what it is. Brothers, your purpose must come before your relationship. Every man knows that his highest purpose in life cannot be reduced to any particular relationship. If a brother prioritizes his relationship over his highest purpose, he weakens himself, deserves the divine, and cheats his woman of an authentic man who can offer her that which is real and heartfelt. If you had to choose one or the other, intimacy or succeeding at your purpose, your mission will always be your priority. Brother over there said amen. Unless you know your mission, though, this is a challenge. Unless you know your mission and have connected your everyday life to it, your core will feel empty. Your presence in the world will be weakened, as will your presence with your woman. If you don't know your purpose, discover it now. Without a conscious life purpose, a man is totally lost, drifting and adapting to events rather than creating events. Without knowing your life purpose, a brother becomes weakened, even sexually impotent, or prone to be disinterested in sex. The core of your life is your purpose. Everything in your life must be aligned with your purpose, from your diet to your career. To know your purpose, your deepest desire, then for you, the secret of success is to discipline your life so that you minimize distractions and your detours. If you don't know your purpose, then all hell breaks loose. Your essential core is empty. This being, this state of being, is the source for all of you brothers. It is never changing and always present. You have to get to a place where you can feel the core of that source. The essential you is your core. It is your source. Feel that as deeply as possible. Then reapproach after you have gone there. Reapproach your work. Reapproach your intimacy, your family, and all the creative efforts that you put into your life. When you make love from this source. When you make money from this source. Read books that constantly remind you of who you are, the essence of your own truth. Spend time with folks that inspire you and reflect the source within you. It's hard to fly like an eagle when you're surrounded by turkeys. meditate, contemplate, feel the silence in that source, come to know its eternity. If you postpone the process and connect it with this source by taking care of business first, you will find that your business will be incomplete and fleeting. Only if you are grounded in that which is larger than this life will you be able to play life with humor and consistency, and to feel the truth of who you are. Discipline, the nature of spiritual discipline, is what makes us limitless in what it is that we do or feel we have to do, that creates our visions for us. You know? So as men, because the masculine is the mission, purpose is very key to your life essence. And if you haven't discovered your purpose, then you're on a downward spiral as opposed to upward mobility. A lot of times in relationship, men find themselves in a place where they're like, you know, man, you know, this woman, wow, nag, 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 nag. Damn, you know? I mean, all she does is complain. Think about this. She's complaining for a number of different reasons. And if she's complaining, she's creating a mirror for us, you know, to look at. Because we're not on our job. Because if we were on our job, she'd still be there. But she's complaining in a different way. This one is titled, Stop Hoping for Your Woman to Get Easier. A woman often test her man's capacity to remain unmoved, unperturbed in his truth and his purpose. She tests you to feel your freedom and depth of love, to know that you remain trustable. Her tests may come in the form of complaining, challenging you, changing her mind for your reaction, distracting you, or even undermining what you feel is your purpose in a subtle or not so subtle way. A man should never think his woman's testing is going to end and your life will get easier. Rather, you should appreciate that she does these things to keep you in your center so that you both can stay in touch with your strength, integrity, and openness. Her desire is for your deepest truth and love. As you grow, so will her testing. As we, as men, you know, because it's really deep, as men, we come up in a totally different environment, you know, of course, as your sisters do. And the environment that we come up with as men is the environment of challenge, you know? I mean, that's just how we come up. We're enculturated with this from the, you know, because we come up in an exclusively masculine culture. So we get like a whole bushel basket of this as opposed to little increments, you know? Like, I remember, I don't even know how old I was. You know, maybe like in my early teens, you know, like maybe like 12, 13, somewhere around in there. And myself and like a few of my buddies, we were out playing in the field. And there was this fallen log, right? So We were climbing up the log, and then I saw this overhanging branch. So I said, So I jumped from the log and grabbed onto the branch, and I swing, and I just let go, and just bam, jump down. I turned to my boss, I bet you can't do that. He says, I bet I can. I said, well, go ahead, let me see. This is my best friend, right? So he gets up, he jumps, grabs the branch, and swings and loses his grip. He falls, he breaks both his arms. So he's walking around in casts like this. His arms are like this, you know, for like, you know, 6 weeks. But that stands out in my mind so much so because it's the challenge. And it's how we as men come up. And this mindset, this consciousness of challenge, we take into our relationships with our significant others. And this is how we deal with them, not from a standpoint of, you know, loving and tender and nurturing suggestion, but we challenge our women to do this or that. The masculine grows by challenge, but the feminine grows by praise. Masculine has the habit of challenging everyone, including your woman. This is done with the pretense to get her to improve and grow. But instead of saying, you are so beautiful when you smile, the masculine will say, you're so ugly when you frown. They both imply the same thing, trying to get your woman to smile, but it's how they're said. You see that? You see the power that's in that, the difference? If a man knows his woman would be healthier if she exercised more, he should not say it in those terms. Step to your woman, you know, say, you know, that workout outfit that I saw you in like a couple weeks ago, it's like form fitting. That's good. I mean, I could see you in that, like, you know, every day. Your sister, she don't. No.
Straight through that one.
No. So I mean, it's how you frame. It's how you frame your intent. Praise works. Information doesn't. Praise motivates. Challenge doesn't. You should praise your woman at least 10 times a day.
More.
Yeah.
At least.
I said at least. At least.
Don't just praise her.
Change is the only constant. Now, if you remember the slide of the brain, the emotional field is in the right hemisphere of the feminine mind. Emotion is like water. You know, I mean, it's like, it changes all the time. And the only thing that really stabilizes emotion is love. All the varying emotions. That's the one thing that stabilizes all of them is love. So men will say, man, I don't get it. You know, I mean, she say one thing, then she says something else. You know, I mean, like 5 minutes later, she always changing her mind. I mean,
What is that about? Then I approach her about it, and she says, it's a woman prerogative. I mean, can't you just be like in one thought at one time, and then that's just what it is? No. Because the emotional field is fluid, like water. So women, this one I titled, Women Are Not Liars. Keeping your word is a masculine trait in either men or women. A person without a feminine essence may not keep her word, but it is not exactly lying. In feminine reality, words and facts take a second place to emotions and the shifting of moods in relationship. So, think about like situations you've had, like maybe you're at work, brothers at work, he's coming in, you all have a dinner date, or maybe a movie date, you know, to go out at some point. As soon as he gets in, he says, I'll be in at this time, and you say, look, you know, I don't want to wait. You know, are you sure you're going to be in at this time? I'll be there. I'll be there at that time for sure. Okay, I'll be ready. I'm sorry, I was leaving the office and getting off of work. This cat comes in and he starts chatting me up, you know, about, you know, like a new account that he wants to get going. And she's like, work was over. I mean, why couldn't you come back tomorrow? I mean, you know, the day is done. And then you go, because the whole mission and purpose thing kicks in, you go, well, I mean, I'm working. You know what I mean? I'm always working. I mean, it's important. I gotta, you know, I'm making money. I gotta be. And then it's this dynamic that just goes back and forth, you know, and just evolves into like this real negative, tumultuous encounter that it don't even have to go there, right? So just think, like, you rewind it, come in, I'm sorry, look, I've been waiting here for half an hour. Half an hour. No, the movie started like 10 minutes ago. Our reservations have probably been lost. You go, you know, I'm sorry, I'm really sorry. And I'll make it up to you. I promise this evening I'll make it up to you. You just grab it. No. Just. Even if that happens, even if she goes, no. You keep going. You keep moving forward, you know, until you get that response. And you're going to get it. You're going to get that response. Definitely. No.
You should tell them this stuff.
You. No, they gotta know. The masculine means what it says, but the feminine says what it feels. Let me say that again. The masculine means what it says, but the feminine says what it feels. A woman's word is her true expression in the moment. A woman's word is her true expression, key word, in the moment. Change is the only constant. Emotion transcends feelings.
Woman's words are the expression of the essence, nature, or physics of her feelings with respect to that moment in regards to the relationship, situation seen and unseen. Don't believe the literal content of what your woman is saying unless love is flowing deeply and fully in the moment that she says it. Trust. We live in a culture that is so masculine dominant and overwhelmingly like suffocating for the women that we're connected to that they must drop their level of their own feminine energy and essence to deal with this patriarchal, masculine, dominant culture every day. What this does, it means that they have to release and express more of their masculinity to cope with everyday situations. Now, the trust factor is that they have to feel that you as a man are trustable so that when they get home from whatever it is they're doing, that they can drop all of that and come and rest in your arms and re-engage their femininity. The problem is that very rarely happens. And so a woman must always keep that edge, even after she gets home, comes in from work, you know, and she really wants to have that bubble bath there waiting with the oils and the candles and all of that, you know. But it's not forthcoming. A woman must be able to trust you take charge if she relaxes her own masculine edge. This is true financially, sexually, emotionally, and spiritually. You don't have to do all the work, but you must be able to steer the course if your woman is going to relax into the feminine without being fearful. Any questions before I go to the next? How are you all doing? Are you okay? Maybe we need to stand up for a minute. Stand up and just stretch. Breathe in. Come on up, breathe in.
Stretch your desire, masculine, feminine.
Yeah, just kind of twist to the side a little bit, you know?
One good day.
We're almost done. One of the most powerful organs, many will say the most powerful organ in the human body, is the heart. In the East, where you find men who do a lot of energetic practices, first thing that they're going to do, if they're smart or if they have a really, like, it's Christmas. So the heart is access when you really want to do serious practice, because when you start opening up different energetic centers in your body, all kinds of stuff comes up. I mean, all kinds of, like, really negative, toxic, emotional debris. The heart is the only organ in the human body that can transform any and all negative emotions. It's the only one. Every organ in your body corresponds to an emotion. So your liver, for example, corresponds to anger. Your kidneys correspond to fear. Your lungs correspond to sadness, despair, depression. Pancreas, spleen, corresponds to worry, anxiety. So all of these different emotional fields exist within the various organs in your body. So when you go into wanting to, like, really create balance, true internal balance in yourself, the first thing you have to learn how to do is to release these negative, toxic energies from their respective organs. And once these energies are released, it's the heart that transforms those energies into a much higher vibrational field. For the longest time, it was believed that the brain was the battery of the body, that it created more energy, electromagnetic force in the human body than anything else. But now they know that the heart creates 500 times the rate of electromagnetic energy than the brain. 500 times. The heart extends a field around each and every one of you that is 15 feet around. 15 feet around. This one scientist by the name of David R. Hawkins wrote two books. One was called Power Versus Force, and the other book is Truth Versus Falsehood. He was able to measure the field ratio of different emotional states. And what he found was, like, for example, fear, he measured at 200. Then he went to unconditional love, as expressed from the heart. Unconditional love. He measured unconditional love at 500. And what he found was that a person, one individual, occupying that state of unconditional love can shift or counterbalance 750,000 people, that one person, being in that state. Now you have to stop and think about how many individuals do we know walking around in a state like that? Unconditional love? How many folks do you know that are in that state of unconditional love? How many of your significant others that you've had through the course of your life have been in that place of unconditional love? Because when we come together in the mix,
There are always, always, right? Conditions. There are always conditions. Because our relationships are based on fear, dependency, stress related. Always. This same scientist found that when a person shifts into divine love, divine frequency, that he measured between 600 and 700, that person ain't even got to leave the room, because what? We're all connected. We're all connected. This connection is the greatest illusion that's ever been perpetrated upon the human race. The fact that we're all connected, that person, being at that vibrational frequency of 600, 700 in divine love, can lift the consciousness of 70 million people in the United States. 70 million people. Now you go back to the beginning of what the ancient Egyptians said with respect to us coming here and being connected to 2,000 souls, and every time we elevate ourselves or have a major breakthrough, those 2,000 souls that are connected to us automatically have that breakthrough and that same elevation of consciousness. So you see the connectedness between the ancient model and the current science. No, I mean, ancestors were profound, indeed. The heart is an amazing organ. So I'd like to read something very quickly. I call it Program 2.0. Program Love 2.0. Tech support. Yes, ma'am. How can I help you? Customer. Well, after much consideration, I've decided to install Love. Can you guide me through the process? Tech support. Yes, I can help you. Are you ready to proceed? Customer. Well, I'm not very technical, but I think I'm ready. What do I do first? Tech support. The first step is to open your heart. Have you located your heart, man? Customer, yes. But there are several other programs running right now. Is it okay to install Love while they are running? Customer, yes. Tech support. The first step is to open your heart. Have you located your heart? Tech support, what programs are running, man? Customer, let's see. I have past hurt, low self-esteem, grudge, and resentment running right now. Hey, that's what we got. Tech support, no problem. Love will gradually erase past hurt from your current operating system. It may remain in your permanent memory, but it will no longer disrupt other programs. Love will eventually override low self-esteem with a module of its own called high self-esteem. However, you have to completely turn off grudge and resentment. Those programs prevent love from being properly installed. Can you turn those off, ma'am? Customer, I don't know how to turn them off. Can you tell me how? Tech support, with pleasure. Go to your start menu and invoke forgiveness. Do this as many times as necessary until grudge and resentment have completely been erased. Customer, okay, done. Love has started installing itself. Like, is that normal? Tech support, yes. But remember that you have only the base program.
You need to begin connecting to others' hearts in order to get the upgrades. Customer, wow, I have an error message already. It says, error program not run on external components. What should I do? Tech support. Don't worry, ma'am. It means the love program is set up to run on internal hearts, but has not yet been run on your own heart. In non-technical terms, ma'am, it means you must love yourself before you can love others. Customer, so what do I do? Tech support. Can you pull down self-acceptance? Then click on the following files. Forgive self. Realize your worth. Acknowledge your limitations. Customer, okay, I've done it. Tech support, now, copy them to the My Heart directory. The system will overwrite any conflicting files and begin patching faulty programming. Also, you need to delete verbose self-criticism and all directories and empty your recycle bin to make sure that it is completely gone and never comes back. Customer, okay, I got it. Whoa, my heart is filling up with new files. Smile is playing on my monitor, and peace and contentment are copying themselves all over my heart. Is that normal? Tech support, sometimes. For others, it takes a while. But eventually, everything gets downloaded at the proper time. So love is installed and running. One more thing before we hang up. Love is freeware. Be sure to give it and its various modules to everyone you meet. They will, in turn, share it with others and return some cool modules back to you. Customer, I promise to do just that. By the way, what is your name? Tech support. Just call me the Divine Cardiologist, also known as the Great Physician, or just I Am. Most people feel all they need is an annual checkup to stay heart healthy. But the manufacturer, which is me, suggests a daily maintenance schedule for maximum love efficiency. Keep in touch. So in closing, in relationships with respect to love, we've got, or what I term anyway, counterfeit love and empowering love. So what does that look like? Counterfeit love. A person who confuses inauthentic love with the real thing will typically seek outside for love. So no self-love, this individual is always looking for other things, either to love or to create the pretense of love. Gotta get it from somewhere else. Confuses love with infatuation, or the falling in love syndrome. Counterfeit love, worry. Counterfeit love is always about trying to control the other person that you're connected to, not establishing that freedom, the trust that comes with the relationship. Try to barter for love, buy love. Again, this kind of goes and works in tandem with the first, you know, using and trying to connect with love on the outside. So love becomes very superficial. It becomes things. Whereas the first thing a woman is going to want to feel is like that heart energy, you know. Then other things can follow behind that if she knows and understands that that's real. But when you first meet someone and you begin showering them with gifts,
know? I mean, you have to really look at, this ain't real. This isn't, you know, this individual confuses things with love. And things are not love. Like in the States, we got this basketball player, brother by the name of Kobe Bryant. A couple years ago, he got in, some really deep stuff with, having a sexual encounter outside of his marriage. And, I mean, the whole world is looking at this, right? Well, maybe not. Like, all of the West is looking at this. Okay, what is this brother? So a lot of heat is coming down on this brother. So one of the things that he does, he says, wow, now the whole world is looking. And I was thinking to myself, well, how do people even know this? You know, how do the media, how does the media, get this kind of information? So anyway, he goes out and buys this $4.2 million diamond ring. I'm like, wow, it's like a yellow diamond, like one in a yellow diamond. $4.2 million. So everybody's like, oh, Kobe loves his woman. He bought her a $4.2 million ring. You know this brother is in love with this woman. And I'm thinking, you got to be out of your mind. That's the weakest, what is $4 million to a brother that's making $18 million a year or $20 million a year, So the whole effort, was really weak. But it showed me just how we're tied in to the misconception of what love is. Counterfeit love confuses love with passion and need. That's a state that's very easily exhausted, especially for the brothers, because, see, this is the thing. Sex energy is life force. So if you are emitting your life force constantly, continuously, over and over again, then what happens, it triggers a psychological response. That psychological response is saying that this person, this woman that is sucking out your life energy, she ain't my friend because she's killing me. So she becomes my enemy. So then, that trigger begins to send a message to that brother to I need to start backing away. So he begins to lose interest. He becomes more and more disinterested in the sex. Before you know it, that freedom dynamic sets in. That brother is looking over here at this woman, looking over here at that woman, looking over there, looking to find somewhere else, because he's not in touch with the psychological mechanism that is really in play. The more he loses the life essence, the more he ejaculates that essence out of his body into that woman, the more the body determines that that woman is unfriendly. And it sets up all the necessary response modes to take care of making sure that that woman doesn't take any more of its life essence. So, passion and need are easily exhausted, gone like that. And brothers, if you think about it, you can measure the power. When it's gone. And the sisters are going, damn, that's 3 minutes.
Counterfeit love leaves you depleted, exhausted, and a feeling of just like you've given out everything that you have. There's no consistency, it's up, it's down. It's the kind of love that brings pain and suffering. Later, not soon. Empowering love that you find in an empowering relationship. Authentic love leads to true intimate connection and mutual empowerment because it's based on unconditional love, which is a very deep place to arise. Unconditional love, a conscious, rational decision to view a person without judgment, committed to that individual, regardless of what he or she sees in that individual, knowing that the essence of that individual, you know, is untainted, is pure. But we all carry our baggage because all of us are damaged goods. So it's all about growth. It's all about how we need to evolve in our relationships. You know, so when you're in a relationship, you want that to be one of the prime features of that relationship. That person you're involved with is based and intent on transforming themselves, on always growing, evolving. And not just in the intellect, because see, we have this thing where we believe if we read more and more, you know, then we're grown. But no, only the intellectual mind is grown. That has nothing to do with how you're changing or repatterning yourself energetically, which brings about true change. Care, respect, responsibility, and knowledge. A desire to contribute to other person, to the other person's growth and happiness. The gift of freedom. Kindness, generosity, consistent strength, joy, happiness, energy, and healing. Powerful shifting, automatic. In love, the emotion behind the desire will create the actual outcome. What is your true intention? As I said earlier, your desire, if you desire a relationship because you are lonely, you create more loneliness. The emotion behind the desire is fear. Make sure that the emotion behind your desire is love. And you will create more love. And that's what you will attract to you. How to impress a woman. Compliment her. Cuddle her. Kiss her, caress her, love her, and stroke her. Tease her, comfort her, protect her, hug her, hold her, spend money on her, wine and dine her. Buy things for her. Listen to her, care for her, stand by her, support her, buy flowers for her, go to the ends of earth for her. How to impress a man. Show up naked, bring beer. Don't switch.